by any other form of music. Improvised and noise music nonetheless exists in capitalism. Since we cannot accept that noise or improvisation is by default anti-capitalist music, then we need to look more closely at those resistances and tensions this music carries within itself, where it provides potential tools for capitalism, and where it supplies means for getting out of it. In the mid-1980s, noise music seemed to be everywhere across the oceans and circulating in continents from Europe and North America to Asia, especially Japan and Australia. Musicians of diverse background were generating their own variants of noise performance. Some 20 years later, the bombed-out factories of Providence, Rhode Island, the shift of New York's downtown scene to Brooklyn, appalling inequalities of the Detroit area, and growing social cleavages in Osaka and Tokyo, brought noise back to the center of attention. Music in its most uncompromising form is different from other forms of resistance music such as punk, new wave, hardcore, or dark metal. In these musics, the voice, a logo says truth, has constituted the ideal point of a criticized voice by claiming to speak the truth of its audience's situation. Noise has no such claims. It is a radical deconstruction of the status of artist, audience, and music. It is the grain of the voice, a refusal of representation, the refusal of identity. Noise, at the very least, disrupts both the performer and listener's normal relations to the symbolic order, by refusing to loop music or pleasure through the symbolic order. Symbolic relations are defined here as an aggregate of guilt, the law, achievement, authority figures. If you protest using their tools, such as their legal system, they know what you want, and it becomes easy for them to give it to you, and to shut you up. A quick and superficial fix that momentarily makes happy the people underneath. But fundamentally nothing has really changed. And of course this system will continue to produce misery and frustration.